Good morning, friends. Let me congratulate my good friend and the CEO of NSE, Mr. Vikram Lime, Mr. Naveen Korpe, and of course all those who have been responsible behind launch of this very interesting event. When 100th IPO is now listed today, and happy to see it is oversubscribed several times over. So let me congratulate the promoter, and I wish all the best for the investor, because ultimately those who have made the invested the money, they should get properly rewarded over a period of time, not on the day of the listing, but particularly after the listing. So let me wish them all the best. And I'm sure it's a very interesting event, because we are on the threshold of a big recovery in Indian economy. Our GDP is undergoing a very profound change. The launch of programs by the Prime Minister, whether it is Make in India, whether it is Startup India, whether several structural reforms which have been initiated to make our economy more transparent, efficient, productive, and forward-looking, will now start showing results as we go along. So you will see that the share of manufacturing in GDP will rise. At the same time, services will also continue to grow. And our now effort to double farmers' income in the next 5 years would mean that there is going to be another driver for Indian economy. Just imagine, almost 2/3 of the population who are directly dependent or indirectly dependent on agriculture, if their income doubles, how much of purchasing power will be available in the hands of the people? And where would they spend? They would either spend in consumption, or this will be converted into savings. In turn, both will drive the growth. When the savings will rise, part of them will get converted into NSE. Some of this will come to Mr. Korpe's company. And even consumption would drive the demand for all these various scripts which are listed here. And therefore, a significant amount of change is in the offing. Make in India would mean that share of manufacturing to GDP will significantly increase. And we are working on that in a very structured way. And that's my job as a Minister of Commerce and Industry, and particularly as a Minister of Industry, wherein we are trying to promote a huge development of manufacturing in India by doing several things. One is to modernize our existing manufacturing industries, which are traditionally been there in India, and we have been known to be expert in running those industries, whether it is textiles, whether it is commodities oriented businesses. So those will be modernized. At the same time, we are seeing emergence of new industry, which I would not say very new, but relatively new. Like I was just watching that a performance of pharma sector, which is also improving over a period of time. So pharmaceutical, will not call it as traditional as the textiles, but still a now well settled industry in India, and particularly the generics, wherein we are able to manufacture pharma products, not just for domestic market, but for global markets. The third portion of industrialization, one will be, as I said, the modernization of the existing one, promoting industries like pharmaceuticals. And the third one, which we are working on, is to identify 6 or 7 critical sectors, which are not even emerged today, but they will be the futuristic industries that will be now required to take care of the changing global economic perspective. And we are in the process of identifying those industries, and we are talking to top-class global experts, including some multilateral agencies, and in the next few months would actually start working on those industries. Of course, not that government is going to start industries. We'll be allowing and facilitating private sector to come in and make investment to those sectors. So this is the strategy for making sure that industry will continue to grow, and this will actually start yielding tremendous results when we'll see that manufacturing start growing. It will have a huge positive impact, the pull impact, on the services sector as well. The other part, and I'll come to services later, which is your business. The other part is the exports. And we saw a great movement into exports. September exports were quite good. October, obviously, there has been some correction because of we had already started acting on the initial process necessary to adopt to the new GST regime, and therefore we actually took a lot of steps, but that were taken on the 8th of October. So we'll see a result of that in the next few months. But exports have to rise in a significant way, and we are also preparing a strategy for that in terms of identifying the markets where India has already invested hugely by way of geopolitical capital, by way of human resource capital, but now the economic engagement in those regions is not as high as it should be. So we are working on that. We are working on the top 10 commodity, top 10 items of exports. We are focusing on that, but also identifying new areas and new products where we can export. So this is again a strategy which I am sure in the next few years' time will yield significant results. I was in Latin America, I was in Central America, I was in East Asia, I was in Southeast Asia. Obviously, I was also in the neighborhood. But we are also into Scandinavia, and each of these markets, we are actually now trying to promote, providing an umbrella support by the government support, and will allow the private sector to come in a very significant way. So the idea is, export themselves will drive the economic growth. Manufacturing will also put tremendous push to the economic growth. And all of this, as I said, even agriculture, which is the doubling of agriculture income, and a significant part of our GDP today, in any case, is services. Almost more than 60% of the GDP comes from services, and therefore we are actually trying to promote services exports also. In fact, the goods export could not rise as high at the rate at which service exports will rise. So we are now trying to promote service exports, and unlike goods, services speak languages. The manpower that you are going to recruit, they must speak a language. The goods need not speak a language. If you export garments, garments need not speak a language. But goods have to, the services have to speak language. Therefore, service delivery must be happening in a manner that we must understand the local and the region in which we are going to export. So we are trying to work out some strategies. For example, in Panama, we are trying to, I talked to the president of the country and said, we could make it as a hub wherein we can deliver services through Latin America to Central America through that hub by locating people there and making sure that service delivery happens. So I already asked NASCOM to go and visit immediately as a follow-up, and therefore we'll try to find that out. So services will grow at a much faster rate, which will drive demand domestically as well as globally. I am very impressed with your business model. You are trying to recruit people of high-ended professionals which are required to run very important businesses, whether it's oil and gas, whether infrastructure. These are the kind of people who would actually make sure that businesses are run properly. But just imagine the back-ended benefit of it. And there is always a linkage between services and goods. Because if you invest into infrastructure, there is a need for manpower, and therefore the service sector will also grow like the one you are doing. And I am very happy that market has realized it, because it's oversubscribed several times over, realizing the need for providing critical manpower to run such infrastructure businesses. And infrastructure